And thanks for inviting me again to speak at STM Innovations. So the title that you've got in your packet is Crossref Contributor ID. And there's a story, I guess, again with STM Innovations, and you'd think I'd learn by now. But I think it was 2005, I was first asked to speak at STM Innovations. And the topic that was given to me was the future of aggregation services. And so I prepared my slides, and it was the first and last time I ever submitted my slides in advance. Because between the time that I submitted my slides and the time that I spoke, Google Scholar launched. So you'd think I'd have learned. But no, I decided that I would submit my title here, Crossref Contributor ID. And I, in light of the announcement of ORCID, an announcement that you have in your packets, have switched this. I am no longer going to talk about Crossref Contributor ID. I am instead going to talk about author identity, the shape of the problem. Because I hope later on we'll hear a little bit more about ORCID and an effort that Crossref is very enthusiastic about, which is a broad stakeholder approach to trying to solve the author identity problem. So with that in mind, let's just start off with the big question, which is, why do we care? Why do we care about author ID? Why should we care about author ID? And the answer, I think, is pretty simple. It has to do with this thing that we are all concerned about, the scholarly record. Now, the fact that you're even giggling at this says something about your age, because I've given this presentation at Science Online, a bunch of sort of young whippersnapper science bloggers, and they looked at this and kind of scratched their heads for a little while. It's like, what's that? Anyway, and the scholarly record is, of course, about trust. And the trust that the scholarly record brings to content is based on provenance. Knowing something about how something was produced, where it was produced, and who produced it is a critical function of your evaluation of the content. And there's something that I think that we lose track of a little bit. We are rightfully very concerned about our brands. And our brands are vital, and they are the first and primary pass mechanisms that people use for evaluating whether something is relevant, whether something is good, whether something is important. But we have to remember that all of these brands started with nobody knowing about them. And all of these brands actually share something in common, and that is that they're built on a trust or provenance infrastructure. And that provenance infrastructure is made up, I think, of three fundamental pillars, and that is an infrastructure that allows you across publications, no matter what scholarly publication you're looking at, determine what it is that you're looking at, where you can get it, what refers to it, and what does it refer to. We all do these things. We don't really even think about it anymore. Similarly, we want to know what's been done to it, who provides stewardship of it, that is, who provides updates or retracts it or withdraws it if something goes wrong. But also we want to know who do we credit it to and what are their credentials. And it's this last pillar, I think, here that's really missing and that's causing us great pain in the scholarly publication work area. So specifically, what are the kinds of things that we want to know when we're trying to determine provenance? Well, clearly, given a work, we want to know who's responsible for it and describe the nature of that responsibility. So if we have a paper, we would like to know that Jeffrey Builder is the first author, that Ed Pence is the second author, and that perhaps Anthony Watkinson edited it. Anthony here? But we're focusing on papers here, and one of the things that we learned in Crossref as we were going around trying to figure out, you know, what the requirements were, what the user requirements were for a contributor ID system, was just precisely this. It's not just about authorship, and it's not just about journals. There are lots of ways in which researchers contribute to the scholarly process, and there is increasing agitation on the part of researchers, on the part of funders, on the part of evaluation committees to try and figure out how we can credit them. And of course, in order to credit them, we have to be able to actually identify who they are. So if somebody's written a programmer, you might want to know that Lee Dodge was the programmer. If somebody's compiled a data set and deposited it someplace, you might want to know that that was done by Chuck Kosher. So these are the classic examples. We have some others. Given a name, right? Tell me what works they've contributed to and the nature of the contribution. So again, not that I'm vain or anything here, but you know, it might be that you want to know that I compiled this data set, that I was the author of these articles, that I programmed this program, and that I reviewed these other articles over here. Another one, and these are, again, sort of the very fundamental things, given a name, tell me what other names are related to the first name, and tell me what the nature of that relationship is. So again, you know, that I was a co-author with Ed, that Ed and Chuck are my colleagues and therefore might not be suitable people for reviewing any future articles by me, that I was edited by, again, Anthony Watkinson, that I co-developed some software with Lee Dodds. Now, those three very basic examples are examples that are dear to many stakeholders. And this is the other critical thing that we learned as we were doing research at Crossref into what it would take to develop a contributor ID system. Now, funnily enough, naturally, this is not just a publisher issue. Researchers have a little bit of a concern about this. They want to know that the information that's being gathered about them, that's being reported on them, is accurate. They have a vital interest in them. It could, you know, it can affect their careers. Libraries have a vital interest, a very important interest in collecting the information that's published in their institutions. The institutions have a vital interest in being able to evaluate the people in their institutions and determine what they're publishing and whether or not it was worth something. Funding agencies have a vital role in determining who's been funded and what they've done and whether or not they've gotten return on investment. Intermediaries, and you know, not last but not least, publishers. But it was this thing that we discovered out there as we went and we talked to lots of different people. We kept getting calls and people, you know, researchers would come and they'd say, we hear you're working on this author ID problem. Have you considered this use case? And have you considered that use case? And it was starting to become clearly obvious that in order to do this properly, we had to involve more stakeholders. So what are the problems with this issue? I mean, why is this hard? I mean, surely in the internet we should be able to just do something simple and fix this. Well, I want to go over some of the problems, and I'm going to focus on one particular area of author identity. Because one of the problems when you talk about author identity, or when you talk about identity in general, is people conflate two broad categories of applications for identity. One is security and access control. Chances are if you go and you start talking to your IT group about identity, they're going to start talking to you about Shibboleth and about Kerberos and about all sorts of stuff that we are kind of concerned about, but that's slightly orthogonal to the main issues that we have. We're interested primarily in the knowledge discovery applications of an author identifier. Okay, so it's not the security stuff, it's discovering stuff that we want to be able to do. And the problems are familiar. So there's variation in names. There's name collision. And name collision is common, even with relatively unusual names. This, for those of you who don't know, is called a kite wing. This is something that some very brave soul straps themselves to and hurls off of mountains on. Now, why am I bringing this up? Well, here's a video that you might find on YouTube about a kite wing user. It's a very impressive video. It's absolutely terrifying. And if you look very closely up at the URL, and in fact, if you look at the page further, you will see it's Jeff Bilder with his kite wing. Now, in case you hadn't guessed, that's not me. This is about as dangerous as I get. Name collision is a huge problem, and it's a problem even with relatively unusual names. It's going to get worse because name variation in developing in Asian countries, name collision increases. And then you have all sorts of other problems. So for instance, all of these Chinese characters translate roughly into the romanization Wei Wang. And people will often romanize their name this way. And the problem with this is that it doesn't actually work backwards. You can't figure out from the Wei Wang which one of these combinations of characters you're actually referring to. All right, so we've got name collision. We've got name changes. Some of them are more unusual than others. But they have to be accounted for. Now, you know, ideally what we'd like to be able to do is run out to every conference, pin people down, and do a DNA swap. and that would solve all the problems. But we can't do that. And this actually leads to another set of issues that I think we have to consider when we're talking about this, and that is the terminology itself revolving around identification is actually really confusing. People use identity and identifier the same way often, and they'll often conflate the terms identity, identifier, and profile and persona. And these aren't the same things. There are subtle differences between them, and I think it's important to understand them because it helps us define what it is that we're actually interested in here, and it makes sure that we don't get confused when we're talking about things. So I'd like to start off with the subject. All right, now this is going to be a little bit like the picture of the pipe. You know, this is not my pipe. This is not really me, but it's supposed to represent me. So the subject, in this case, is me. And I often will have multiple identifiers. And identifiers can be all sorts of different things. They can be names. And we already know what the problem with names are, and that is that you have variations, you have collisions, and so on and so forth. But they can be other things, like social security numbers, fingerprints, retinal scans, Q codes, a whole variety of login names. Again, variation there. All of these things can be identifiers. And I think one of the problems that you encounter when you're dealing with identity is when you create identifiers based on things that you think are permanent and immutable and uncopyable, but they turn out to either be not permanent or not immutable or not uncopyable or not universal. You get into trouble if you decide to define identity based on getting the fingerprints of all 10 digits, and some people don't have 10 digits, right? You get into problems if you try and disambiguate based on sex, and people can go off and change their sex. So people make a lot of naive decisions about identifiers, things that seem like they should be rock solid but aren't, and we have to be very careful about those. Next concept I'd like to talk about is the concept of a profile. Now, a profile, this is where we get to what we're really kind of concerned about. We want to know attributes about a person. We want to know attributes associated with an identity. We want to know, for instance, what their email address is, what institution they might be affiliated with, what their blog is, what their publications are. This is the information that we want to be able to gather about an identity in order to be able to do things like, say, find out what else they've published or whether they're a reasonable reviewer or something like that. And of course, we've got so many of these things out there on the internet that it's actually becoming a problem. And this gets us to another concept that you'll often see in identity, and that is the identity of a persona. So there's me, the subject, but I often have profiles based on different personas, different, you know, roles that I play. So the example might be that my profile persona as a researcher is slightly different than my persona as, my persona as an author might be slightly different than my persona as a reader. And I might have lots of these different personas. The one is World of Warcraft player, as artist, as player of the electric ukulele, as potential cross-dresser. And I might even have a persona that is quite consistently and logically anti-ID scheme in the government, for a government ID scheme, because what I don't want somebody to do is link all of these personas. I want to be able to keep these things separate. So what we're concerned about, and the thing we can't forget, is that we're concerned about the persona of a subject as far as it relates to doing academic and scholarly research. The other stuff is inappropriate. We don't want to touch that. We can't touch that. We have to be very, very careful due to privacy laws and other things about what we do there. Another concept I want to talk about is credentials. I'm going to whip through some of these things, but these are the kinds of things that you present to someone to prove that you have certain attributes. All right, a passport says that I'm a citizen, so on and so forth. A username and password might prove that I have access to a system. Another thing that's often conflated when you talk about identity is a protocol. So there, for instance, there are lots of different protocols out there for implementing identity systems. The most recent one that's talked about a lot is OpenID. And it's a very important protocol, but it doesn't actually answer a whole bunch of the issues about profiles and personas and all of these other things that we're really interested in. It is a protocol for authentication. It doesn't help us on the other stuff. And then finally, another term, and a very important term in our concept context, and that is an assertion. And an assertion is something that you might make about a subject or about an identity that refers to a subject. So for instance, these are assertions. Jeffrey Builder's creditworthy, he's a US citizen, he's a UK citizen, both of which are true, again. Authorized to drive a car, has bought 1,151 songs from iTunes, plays electric ukulele, follows Alan Rainier on Twitter. I like Sichuan food, I am the author of Article X. And one of the things that I want to illustrate here is that there's a difference in the kinds of assertions that are being made here. Some are externally made. That is, some external entity is making an assertion about me. Jeffrey Builder is creditworthy. And some are self-assertions. I like Sichuan food. So I want to talk a little bit about externally asserted identity. And externally asserted identity, again, is something we're all familiar with and that we all sometimes just take as the default form of identity. And that is that, you know, your government issues you a passport or they give you a national insurance card or a social security number. And one thing, one characteristic of externally asserted identity is that there's a heck of a lot of bureaucracy involved. You actually have to have a place where people issue these credentials. You have to go there. You have to get them. They have to check things. Sometimes it doesn't actually involve your knowledge, but it still requires a lot of bureaucracy and a lot of processing power and a lot of cost. So, for instance, your credit history might be gathered without your having to go to a specific place or something, but the cost in administration and bureaucracy in managing the collection of this credit history is quite great. Another characteristic of externally asserted identity is that it, when it fails, if there is no way of fixing it properly, it can have catastrophic results. Are any of you familiar with the movie Brazil? In the movie Brazil, there is a it's a dystopian future in which this low-level bureaucrat who works at the Ministry of Information in this future country, using antiquated equipment, has an insect fly into the equipment and inadvertently change the name of a person from Buttle to Tuttle. All right? And this is the difference between identifying a terrorist and identifying an innocent man. And the innocent man actually gets dragged away and killed, and then this bureaucrat tries to remedy things and fix things up, and it all goes horribly wrong. But it's not just that. I mean, this is, you know, the TSA is a classic example. They've got a no-fly list that nobody knows how you get on it. Nobody knows, more importantly, how you can get off it if you've been put on it mistakenly. This is a big example of externally asserted identity and where it can go wrong, and how if it isn't responsive, if it doesn't let people make corrections, it's deeply resented and mistrusted. Self-asserted identity, on the other hand, is the identity we most encounter on the internet. So it's when you go to these different sites and you sign up and you can basically put in almost any information you want. You can get all of these different accounts. None of them are linked. But there's a common theme here. And that is, if there's low risk, right, you can deal with self-asserted identity. There's a low risk associated with signing up for Pandora. Pandora isn't going to suffer unduly if you say that you're somebody else. You can use the system, you can sign up, you can tell them you're a dog, right? And that doesn't matter. In high-risk situations, self-assertion doesn't really play well. You want externally asserted identity. Now, there's a paradox associated with this, and that is that I, as a subject, have more trust in self-asserted identity than in externally asserted identity. Meanwhile, everybody else probably has more trust in externally associated, asserted identity on me than my self-asserted identity. So there are all sorts of trade-offs here, and that's why I want to talk about another kind of identity, which is a hybrid of self and externally asserted identity. And you see this too. For instance, I can go to Amazon and I can sign up and I can tell them I'm a dog. And they will let me sign up. And I can go and I can browse things and I can look for things and they can think that I have certain musical tastes. But as soon as I go off and I buy something, Then I go to an externally asserted identity organization, a credit card company, and they have this thing called a credit history, and they check it, and they come back, and then Amazon's able to tie that identity to something else, and it becomes pretty clear that it's not a dog buying this stuff anymore. So you can actually create hybrid forms of identity on the internet. And I think that there's a message here. There's something interesting here. One of the first questions that people ask when you say you're going to create a researcher ID scheme is they say, well, how do you identify a researcher? How do you know they're a researcher? And in this case, I think that tying an ID to the DOI is where we can get some leverage. If people have identities, they could make self-claims about what they've published. And those claims by themselves, we might give a certain amount of trust, but not much. But once that ID is submitted along with a manuscript to a publisher, and the publisher takes that ID and puts it through their process, and the author actually gets published, and then the publisher takes that ID and the DOI and redeposits it in Crossref, then we have the equivalent of a hybrid assertion. We have a third party, a publisher, saying, yes, this is the identity that we dealt with, and they're responsible for this DOI. So all of a sudden, you have a different kind of claim. And there's a whole hierarchy of sort of levels of claims that you could have along these lines, some ranging from very untrustworthy, a third party claims that I author an article, to self-claims, to verified claims, and so on and so forth. I think that this is going to be an important thing to build into any ID scheme. I want to talk about the scope of an ID scheme because this is also very important to take into account. Research is international, it's interinstitutional, and it's interdisciplinary. Any ID scheme that is based exclusively on country or institution or discipline is going to give you an incomplete and imperfect record of the scholarly record, picture of the scholarly record. Okay. The other aspect of identity that we have to take into account is that it has to be persistent. And we mean persistent. We mean persistent. We're talking hundreds of years. DOIs go back to 1665. Research is important for a very long time. We have 4 centuries of citation information. And this means that if we do naive things, like we base our identifier on something seemingly permanent like a domain name, gbuilder.com, which is the proposal effectively that OpenID makes, we've got a problem, because in 50 years, when I kick over and die, right, and I lose control of my domain name, right, what happens, hey, thanks a lot. What happens when Georgina Builder comes and buys gbuilder.com? Does she get credit for all of my publications? No, so this is, again, we have to think very carefully about how we create these things so that they're interdisciplinary, so that they're international, so that they span time. The other thing we have to worry about, of course, is scale. We, Crossref, deal with about 200,000 DOI deposits a month. If conservatively you think there are about 5 authors per DOI, and you realize that if you tried to automatically disambiguate them, the best you'd get is 96 to 97%. That sounds pretty high, that sounds pretty good, but it would mean that you'd have 5 to 21,000 failures a month. Now, if we're going to create something that we want everybody to use, we're talking about 6 million researchers, 6.7 million graduate students. We need to make sure that we have a mechanism for people to correct things on their own, because we cannot create a bureaucracy to sort out the errors. Even if we use automated means of disambiguating people, we're going to have an error bar that is very high. We need some mechanism to allow researchers to actually fix their own information. So with those thoughts in mind, again, I sort of wanted to give you a very broad picture of the issues that you face when we're creating a contributor ID system for our industry. And I want to end with some principles that I think we need to keep in mind as we design a contributor ID system for the future. The first is that it's got to be designed to support the creation of a clear and unambiguous record of scholarly communication. This is, after all, the motivation behind it. The second is that it has to transcend discipline, geographic and national and institutional boundaries, because research transcends those. The third is that it should be designed to identify contributors, not just authors. There are lots of ways in which people contribute to the scholarly process that are not being measured properly now, and that people need to be able to measure. We need to accommodate this from the start. It's got to support reliable attribution for both formally and informally published literature. It should be open, okay? Now, here's a slight contradiction. Whilst complying to the privacy requirements of the individual as well as various legal jurisdictions, it should be persistent. It has to last hundreds of years. This is not just a technological imperative, it's a social imperative. The organization that's created in order to manage this has to be around managing it well into the future. And lastly, it's got to be controlled ultimately by the contributor or it's going to be rejected wholesale. So thank you very much. Now we're going to actually hear about some concrete proposals for solving these issues, but I'll answer questions afterwards.